Good afternoon, Trinidad and Tobago. I'm Karen Kozier-Phillips. CNews is live at noon. Topping the news at this time, well, as it stands, the stay on the collection of the property tax forms will remain in effect, born out of a ruling handed down by High Court Judge Frank Sipasad on Friday. The matter was taken to the Court of Appeal today, where confusion seemed still to be looming, as attorney Anand Ram Logan claimed they were not made aware the matter would be heard at the court today. He claimed the attorney general had unfair privilege as he questioned how he was able to predict the hearing since last Friday. He also said his legal team had not been aware that there were two appeals brought to the court. But Justice Peter Jamadar, who presided on the matter, described Mr. Ram Logan's claim as abundantly premature and said the concern must be taken up with the administrative arm of the judicial system, who deals with the rostering of cases. Submissions for the appeal were made just minutes before the proceeding began, which led Justice Jamadar to postpone the commencement, as he said he would need to become familiar with the material in the best interest of true justice. The matter will resume on June 6th, where the hearing for the two appeals are expected to begin. While speaking with reporters after court, attorney Anand Ram Logan clarified that last Friday's ruling is still in effect.
The stay remains effective, valid, and in place. That means no citizen of Trinidad and Tobago has any obligation or duty to file any return form or give their house and land deed and the whole range of other things they want. Nobody has to comply with that.
Well, prior to the appeal court's dismissal, the Minister of Finance sought to clear the air. The Minister of Finance and Acting Prime Minister Colm Imbert issued a statement on Sunday to refute claims by opposition leader Kamla Prasad Bisesa. Minister Imbert said he did not speak in Parliament on Friday, May 19th, about the legal action brought by Mr. Maharaj against the Commissioner of Valuations about valuation return forms. He said he was contacted on Friday evening by the media and said the decision will be appealed. The finance minister said attorneys for the Commissioner of Valuations made efforts to get an urgent hearing before the Court of Appeal on Friday, but they were advised that the Court of Appeal would convene on Monday. While Attorney General Faris Al-Rawi said the United National Congress is within their rights to prevent the government from implementing the property tax, but he said it's also the government's right to fight it in the courts.
Then the Ministry of Finance, which has the responsibility for dealing with the property tax, will speak to those issues. Okay. But suffice it to say, what's required right now is some clarity. Let the dust settle. Persons have a legitimate right to go to court, and they have. The appeal court will be moved tomorrow. The appeals have been lodged. The paperwork will be settled, as is the norm. I understand that the leader of the opposition is reinventing the method by which people can approach the court, and they continue to fight litigation in the press as opposed to in the court. All that I ask is for this country to simply settle down. Persons have approached the court. The court is now with jurisdiction in these matters as a certain aspect of clarification.
A member of Parliament for San Fernando West was speaking with the media after attending an event at San Fernando Hill on Sunday. He also refuted questions that the government did not follow proper procedure in effecting the property tax.
We have followed all the proper processes. Anybody who has been to court on emergency basis can testify to this for you. And really, they are condemning some of the most notable attorneys in Trinidad and Tobago. Are they saying that Mr. Martineau, Mrs. Peak, Mr. Fayad Hussein, the Chief State Solicitor, that these are all incompetent people who are in collusion with some fabric of dissonance? I mean, that has just got to be ridiculous. So I denounce it outright, and I ask you not to pay attention to foolishness.
This is the CNews Live Report at noon. Remember, you can keep up to date with all the latest news on our website at ctvtt.com. Or you can check out our Facebook and Twitter pages at CNews Live. To some crime news now, police are investigating two homicides in Princestown and St. Augustine, respectively. Late on Sunday, police responded to a murder in St. Augustine. Keston Venus, a PH taxi driver, was shot dead on Mohammed Street near to Gordon Street corner. CNews understands the incident occurred shortly after 11 p.m. In the earlier incident, the badly decomposed body of a man was discovered at Sisters Road in Princesstown. The body was discovered at around 6:30 p.m. on Sunday. An autopsy is expected to be conducted to ascertain cause of death. Still in crime news, police have confirmed the body found on Sunday under the Chase Village flyover has been identified as Bisnath Jagmohan, age 62, from Grand Coover. Police say the death may be natural as no marks of violence were seen on the body. The president of the Parent Teachers Association of the Tranquility Government Primary School was arrested outside the school alongside another parent as they protested the lack of air conditioning at the school. Peter Christopher tells us more.
This was the scene outside the Tranquility Government Primary School this morning. Parents upset with the condition of the school, and particularly the lack of air conditioning at the school, raised pickets on the pavement on Tragwick Road and Stanmore Avenue near the school entrance. When CNews arrived, the president of the PTA, Chad Barkley, and another parent, Sita Humphrey, had been taken into police custody. Other parents were still engaged in a verbal standoff with an officer who accused them of obstructing the roadway.
Everybody fed up!
Hey, we kill this boy! Hey, we kill this boy!
The vice president of the PTA told CNews what transpired.
Disturbed also because our president was just arrested in full view of other parents. And another female parent was pulled off the pavement and put into a squad car with a male officer. So we are upset again because the ministry is not addressing the situation, and now the police has arrested our president.
On Sunday, the Ministry of Education sent out a press release stating the air conditioning would be fixed in a few days. However, members of the PTA were skeptical as previous promises were not kept.
There's been numerous talks with the ministry, there's been letters written, and other people have been lobbying and nothing has happened. So this is another promise. We were given word that the situation would be rectified within the July-August term. But you can understand, having heard this over and over, this makes no sense to us. So we would like to see some traction, some movement with this particular promise this time around.
The air condition problem, which has been ongoing for over 2 years, was exacerbated by the accommodation of the Piccadilly Government Primary School since 2015. The parents said they would be taking their protests to the Ministry of Education towers. Peter Christopher, CNews.
President of the Communication Workers Union, Joseph Remy, says the government needs to rethink its plan for tourism, while again criticizing the announcement of the plan to shut down the TDC and split it into two entities. He explained the current plan gave very little thought and seems to be placed towards the visitor experience currently.
I don't believe we are paying attention to the visitor experience because we are not linking the different things that make the visitor experience one. So the third pillar is connectivity, which is critically important, and that's what we're talking about.
He says the challenges faced on the air and sea bridge are an obstacle in marketing our full tourism product.
I don't believe we are paying attention to the visitor experience because we are not linking the different things that make the visitor experience one. So the third pillar is connectivity, which is critically important, and that's what we're talking about.
Now for the weather. For the period today until midnight, Trinidad, Tobago and the remainder of the Lesser Antilles will see a few cloudy patches during the morning, which will give way to a mainly sunny but hazy and breezy day. There is a small chance of the brisk shower in a few areas. This evening and tonight will be mostly clear at first, but will increase in cloudiness overnight with brisk showers. There's a high concentration of Sahara dust in the area, thus persons with respiratory ailments should take necessary precautions. Seas are expected to be normal to occasionally moderate. Waves will be 2 meters, occasionally to 2.5 meters in open waters and less than 1 meter in sheltered areas. Trinidad and Tobago-born author Ingrid Passard has been named as the Caribbean regional winner of the Commonwealth Short Story Award. Passard's story, The Sweet Sop, was announced as the winner today. She spoke with us about the achievement in a phone interview.
The
really excited to be the regional winner and very humbled. It's a great prize because you're given a good exposure to the literary world. Trinidad is no stranger to winning the regional prize, of course, because last year the regional winner came from Trinidad. It was Lance Dowage. Mm-hmm. And Sharon Miller has actually won the overall prize in 2013. Again, another Trini. So Trinidad's doing really well, and I'm really proud to be flying the flag.
Ms. Passard was one of three TNT writers who were shortlisted for the 2017 Commonwealth Short Story Prize in April. The others were John Lewis Katz and Caroline McKenzie. She will be flown to Singapore for the announcement of the overall winner in June.
The winner of the overall prize will be announced in Singapore at a ceremony on the 30th of June, and they fly all the winners, regional winners, to Singapore, and we have a little ceremony on the Friday the 30th, and then on the weekend we participate in workshops with Singaporean writers. So it's really nice little event that they have planned.
Raising awareness to reduce statistics, those were just some of the goals at the annual Women for Hope Cancer Committee Cancer Walk and Health Fair. The event, which is in its seventh year, took place at the Queen's Park Savannah on Sunday. President of the committee, Joanne Charles, told CNews what the event was all about and the importance of being informed.
And it's in memory of mothers, because we host it on Sunday after Mother's Day annually. So this is the seventh year we're doing it. And we started because I lost an aunt. Well, my sisters and I, we lost an aunt a few years ago to cancer. We didn't know much about it. So we found out about the Cancer Society and we decided that we should help. So we started volunteering with them, and then we eventually started hosting our own event, which has morphed into this.
A 2013 report by the Pan American Health Organization and the World Health Organization stated that Trinidad and Tobago is one of three countries in the region with the highest cancer mortality rate. Ms. Charles also shared the importance of detection.
Well, in Trinidad and Tobago, we're looking at more breast and ovarian for women, definitely prostate for men, and children cancers, usually leukemia. So it's something that's very important and needs to be done. Go, you have your checks done for women, get your pap smear annually, do your self-examination when you're in the shower. I mean, you must know your body, you must know when something feels or looks different.
The much-touted Big Fet by the Sapara Regional Corporation came in for severe criticism on social media after Chairman of the Corporation, Dr. Glenn Ramadas Singh, announced on Facebook last week that there will be a change in the venue because the magistrate declined both licenses for the event to be held at Irwin Park. The Sapara Fet is an annual event on the calendar of the Southern Community that begins with homage to the Feast of La Divina Pastora, or Sapari Mai, and it lasts for about 3 weeks with events culminating in the Big Fet. Well, one of those persons criticizing Dr. Ramadas Singh was Calypsonian Salvon Noel, also known as Mr. Shack. He's demanding accountability from Dr. Ramadas Singh and wants to know how the money allocated to Sapari Fet was spent. And he said the Sapari Fet is a religious cultural festival that is about the heritage of Sapari, the town and the community, and not about Sapari, the electoral district. Our attempts to reach both Dr. Ramadas Singh and Mr. Shack for further comments on Sunday were unsuccessful. Well, up next we have the sport report. Do stay with us. Well, it's time for sport, and we start with track and field. This country's top female sprinter, Michelle Lee Ayi, was second in the 100 meters at the Jamaica Invitational. Ayi got to the line in 11.06 seconds, the same time as eventual winner Morolake Akinosun, whose dip at the line gave her the victory. That's it for sport. And that's how we end our CNews report at noon. I'm Karen Kuzia-Phillip. Remember, for up-to-date and breaking news throughout the day, you can visit the CNews website at ctvtt.com. Do have a good afternoon.